So you probably don't need me to tell you that this is the lower 48 states of America, and you may also recognise this outline, which is mainland China. Now you'll be relieved to know that I haven't chosen to juxtapose these two behemoth countries as some sort of preamble to yet another video about the battle for global domination. You can get plenty of that elsewhere on YouTube, as I'm sure you're only too well aware. Now I've put them together in an attempt to demonstrate something else altogether, namely the sheer scale of another part of our planet, the Arctic Ocean. So let's move our two country outlines up to the top of the world to get an idea of how they would fit into that space. Two of our most populous nations, home to almost 1.8 billion people, fitting quite well, more or less, within the boundaries of our northernmost ocean, an ocean that used to be covered by an ice pack that was several meters thick, and which, despite seasonal ebbs and flows between summer and winter, never really changed much from one year to another, providing a constant, mostly unseen and unreported, but nevertheless absolutely crucial balancing mechanism, not just for temperatures and weather patterns, but also for other life-sustaining systems like our hydrological and carbon cycles. If you watch this channel regularly, you'll have heard me talk many times over the years about the potential impacts of a reduction in the level of that sea ice. I've often wondered though whether my little musings have really managed to put across the magnitude of those consequences, or convey just how little time we've got as a species to pull our fingers out and do something about it. Well, now there's a new research paper just been published that uses bang-up-to-date technology to reassess that situation. And the worst-case scenario, according to that paper's authors, sees us having to deal with an ice-free Arctic Ocean by the end of this decade. That's soon enough for you? Hello, and welcome to Just Ever Think. It's actually only a few weeks since we last took a look at the conditions up in the Arctic. Well over 500,000 people watched our February video examining the slightly disturbing evidence of large swathes of the Arctic permafrost region switching from their long-term status as permanent stores of vast quantities of carbon to their rapidly growing new status as a source of carbon release into the atmosphere. A big driver of that alarming transition is a phenomenon the scientists call Arctic amplification, and arguably the biggest factor in Arctic amplification is the loss of ice from the surface of the Arctic Ocean. And if that body of water was to lose its ice cover altogether, then all kinds of chaos would start to unfold all over the world. I'll come back to that a bit later in the video, but first of all, it's worth just reiterating precisely what the accepted definition of an ice-free Arctic Ocean actually is, because at first glance it's a bit counterintuitive. It actually refers to an area of sea ice less than 1 million square kilometres in extent. Seems like quite a large number to be calling zero, don't you think? But it represents only 7% of the total surface area of the Arctic Ocean. And if we get down to that level, we won't have one big mass of ice floating in the middle of the sea, reflecting sunlight back into space. What we'll most likely get is lots of really small and pretty useless little pockets of very thin ice, mostly hugging the northernmost coastlines in places like Greenland and Canada, leaving the vast open spaces of the ocean almost completely bare, allowing all the energy of the sun to be absorbed into the dark waters. And when you reach that stage, there's really no going back, because the water will simply continue to get warmer and warmer, reducing the amount of winter ice that can form each year, and eventually bringing about a year-round ice-free Arctic Ocean, with no chance of an accumulation of any new ice until an entirely new geological era arrives many thousands of years into the future. So, just for clarity, that's bad. Unsurprisingly then, there's been a great deal of research activity in recent years, coupled with a good amount of frenzied speculation in the press and on social media, around precisely when an ice-free Arctic might happen, which brings us nicely to this new research paper. The co-authors, Céline Hoitze and Alexandra Yarn, made use of data from the Coupled Model Intercomparison Project, or CMIP-6 model, that we've mentioned a couple of times in previous videos, but their approach differed from most other researchers. Instead of trying to analyse when the first monthly ice-free conditions might be witnessed, they were attempting to establish when the first ice-free day might be, which on the face of it seems like quite an ambitious target to shoot for. And indeed, having run hundreds of different scenarios through the modelling software, they came up with an extremely large range of possibilities, from a sort of least terrible timeline of somewhere after the end of this century, all the way down to the fairly apocalyptic projection of sometime in the next 3 years. Now, it's worth noting that the first ice-free day will of course inevitably occur earlier than the first ice-free month. That's just basic logic. Even so, I don't fancy the worst case scenario much at all, quite frankly. But following the time-honoured principle of hope for the best and plan for the worst, you've got to at least have a think about the possibility, haven't you? So our intrepid duo looked at 366 projection runs from four different CMIP-6 models that were predicting an ice-free Arctic sea day within 10 years and isolated projection runs that came out with ice-free days within 3 to 6 years. Then they drilled down into the data from those projection runs, not to try and prove to the world that such an ice-free scenario was definitely going to happen, but to try to understand what could possibly cause such an unlikely but extremely high impact transition in so short a space of time. Those predictive model runs, which the scientists call ensemble members, were all set up relative to an equivalent model state with a daily sea ice area or SIA minimum equal to 3.39 million square kilometres. That provided a common starting point to keep everything equal. Now you might think that the biggest variable affecting the timing of an ice-free day would be our global greenhouse gas emissions. That is, after all, what we're all predominantly focused on in the climate change world, isn't it? But here's the thing. In all except the very lowest of the IPCC's so-called Shared Socioeconomic Pathways, or SSPs, global emissions were not found to be a significant factor in the near-term projections that these researchers analysed. So is that a good thing then? Well, no, not really. I mean, I suppose for absolute completeness, I should clarify that those very lowest SSP models did result in predictions of an ice-free Arctic day no sooner than 2050, and most likely somewhere after the end of the century. But we currently really are nowhere close to achieving that aspirational IPCC goal. So to all intents and purposes, those results can probably be placed firmly in the outlier bin. The more plausible interpretation of the lack of SSP influence is that the majority of the damage from greenhouse gases, at least as far as the Arctic is concerned, has probably already been done, and the flywheel is already in full swing, so to speak. The greatest influence on future Arctic conditions was actually found to come from what the researchers referred to as internal variability. In other words, the difficult to predict stuff, like a freak storm that can break up weak thin ice and cause it to melt away more quickly, which is what contributed to the record minimum in 2012, for example, or maybe extreme warm ocean currents encroaching into the Arctic from the North Atlantic, or perhaps just the way the ice is distributed at the start of the summer season, or even just the variation of cloud cover across the warmer months. All these things can cause a reduction in the reflectivity or albedo of the ice pack and bring about what the oceanographers call rapid ice loss events, or RILES. And that's really what causes such a large range of projected timelines. Doesn't that mean it's all a bit pointless to try and predict these sorts of things then? Well, Hoitse and Jahn tell us this. We find that these early ice-free days all occur during a rapid ice loss event and are associated with strong winter and spring warming. And guess what we've been experiencing during the last few years? A level of global atmospheric and oceanic warming that is unprecedented in the entire span of human history. So, you know, just saying. Now, I mentioned earlier that we'd have a think about the impacts of an ice-free Arctic on our global life support systems. So what are they then? Well, we've already looked at the most obvious implication, which is the loss of a giant reflective shield to bounce massive amounts of the sun's energy back up into space to keep the planet at a comfortable average temperature. That means the job of keeping that temperature below 1.5 or even 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels is made so much more difficult. But there's a bunch of other so-called Earth system tipping points that also get triggered as a result. I'm sure you well-informed folks already know what a tipping point is. The usual analogy that our scientists use is the careless student rocking on their chair until they reach a point where they can no longer stop themselves falling backwards. The difference between staying safely upright or falling and cracking your head rather painfully on the floor is governed by only a tiny difference of movement right at the margin. And it's the same on a planetary scale. We can go right up to the edge of danger without experiencing any existential peril, but nudge just past that point of no return and the whole edifice collapses irreversibly like a house of cards. I've mentioned the work of people like Johan Rockström, Stefan Ramsdorf and others many times in previous videos on this channel. They warn of catastrophic impacts like a rapidly melting Greenland ice sheet, which in total would increase global sea levels by 7 metres or about 21 feet, flooding most of the key trading cities around the world, not to mention wrecking the lives and livelihoods of hundreds of millions of people in vulnerable low-lying developing nations. Then there's the dieback of the Amazon rainforest, as higher temperatures cause greater evapotranspiration from plants, less rainfall across the region, and wildfires to run rampant through a previously wet environment. Those events would rapidly flip the Amazon from a net sink into a net source of carbon as millions of trees go up in flames and release vast quantities of that previously locked up element back up into the atmosphere. We'll also see significant disruptions to ocean circulation patterns as a result of rapidly warming water, which among other things could mean the Gulf Stream no longer delivering its energy to the atmosphere above Western Europe, the mass die-off of essential marine habitats like coral reefs, and essential nutrients and energy no longer being distributed around the world, impacting the marine ecosystems that most human beings ultimately rely on for a major part of their daily diet. Meanwhile, the availability of other components of that diet, like cereal crops for example, which currently provide 50% of all the calories we humans consume, would also be severely impacted by extreme and unpredictable droughts and flooding that we're already seeing, and which would become significantly more chaotic, random and powerful as more and more energy and moisture accumulate in that warming atmosphere I keep going on about. And let's not forget that for every 1 degree Celsius our global atmosphere warms, it can hold 7% more moisture. And then there's the high altitude ribbon of fast moving air known as the jet stream that circles the northern hemisphere. It's driven by the temperature difference between the cold Arctic and the warmer mid latitudes. But as the Arctic is warming 3 or 4 times faster than the rest of the planet, that temperature difference is shrinking. A weaker temperature gradient weakens the jet stream, causing it to slow down and become wavier. And when the jet stream gets wavy, it can cause weather systems to stall, which means longer, more extreme weather events like prolonged heat waves, intense droughts, devastating floods, and brutal cold snaps right around the globe. And the thing is, these tipping points aren't isolated. Each of them can trigger another, like a giant disastrous game of dominoes. Johan Rockström and his colleagues now talk about tipping cascades rather than just tipping points, bringing widespread and irreversible changes to Earth's systems. If we really were negligent enough to allow all of them to happen in the coming decades, then according to the Potsdam team, Earth could transition into a hothouse state with 4 to 5 degrees Celsius of additional warming. That's a planet that would be unrecognisable to you and me, but which may well start to become all too familiar to our kids and grandkids. The good news is that even now, the fate of the Arctic is not yet sealed. There are credible peer-reviewed studies that suggest strong and immediate action to reduce greenhouse gas emissions could slow Arctic melting and perhaps even stabilise it during the second half of this century. Every fraction of a degree matters though. Slower warming means slower ice loss, less feedback and lower risk of tipping cascades. So what has been the reaction to this information from our most powerful political leaders currently strutting around the world stage? Well, if this recent New Scientist article is anything to go by, it seems their number one priority is to exploit the unexpected bonanza of a rapidly melting Arctic region to go on an industrial mining frenzy to dig up the enormous mineral wealth that was previously permanently locked up under all that ice and permafrost. I mean, it's a very clear and ambitious action plan for the future, you have to give them that. It's just not one that has anything to do with the survival of our species, or the millions of species that until just a couple of hundred years ago, we were sharing this planet with in a reasonably sustainable manner. Now, you're all very smart people, so I'll let you make your own mind up about how to respond to that information. And I'm sure many of you will be feeling the urge to share your thoughts with me and your fellow viewers right now. If that's you, then the place to do exactly that is in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to the amazing folks over at Patreon who helped me keep this channel's content completely independent and free of ads and sponsorship messages. If you find these videos useful and informative and you feel you'd like to support me in making more of them each week, then you can do that over at patreon.com/justeverthink, where you'll also get direct access to me via an exclusive messaging forum, plus early access to all my videos and the opportunity to influence the content via monthly polls. And of course, you can also support the channel here on YouTube by hitting the like and subscribe buttons, either down there or via that icon there. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.